Welcome to the Rancho Mirage Public Library. Possibly the best library in this desert, wouldn't you all agree? And I think once we have our observatory done and a few other little tweaks in this building, we will be the best library in Southern California. Our city manager is here, Randy Binder, in the front row, and Randy's a great library supporter and makes sure that our staff and our library is well taken care of. I have the good fortune to be the library director. My name is David Bryant. Year 9 of this journey to excellence, we hope, and rooms full of people like today. Thank you all for coming. Our programming primarily is funded by the Library Foundation. That is our fundraising arm. We're not going to give you a heavy sales pitch today, but if you would like to learn more about it, I'm readily available in the building, and you can call in and just ask for David, and they'll find me somewhere, and we would love to have a chat. So, again, thank you. Today we're going to hear about Sunnylands, America's Midcentury Masterpiece, and by the way, that book will be available after Janice's talk. So it's my pleasure to introduce to you today Micheline Gallagher. I love Micheline's job title. Director of Education and Environmental Programs at the Annenberg Foundation Trust at Sunnylands. Micheline knows what she's doing, as everybody does at Sunnylands, and our partnership with Sunnylands is something we treasure. Again, thank you all for coming. Please welcome Micheline.
Do you want me to bring this down after?
Sure, if you would.
Okay. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming today to this talk by our Executive Director, Janice Lyle. I get the honor of, first of all, thanking the library for this partnership. We are in a few years now of doing the Sunnylands series with Rancho Mirage Library. And in addition, I also want to thank our partnership with Modernism Week that brought this program to us. The desert has offered us a lot of opportunities for collaborative partnerships that make these programs even bigger than when one institution does that. And so it's been a really great honor for us to be working with the Rancho Mirage Library. So because I know everybody's waiting for Janice to speak, I'm not going to say anything else. I'm going to introduce the Executive Director of the Center of Gardens and my boss, Janice Lyle.
Thanks. So of course, Micheline has to say nice things about me because she works for me, right? Today I'm going to talk, I have a title for today's topic. It's High Style, the architecture and design of a mid-century masterpiece. And that's a specific kind of lens that I'm going to use in talking about Sunnylands. Usually, and does this sound too loud to you? No, it's good. Okay. Usually, I talk about a bigger story about Sunnylands. I may talk about the fact that Sunnylands is a special place where its history it continues to play an important role in the high-level retreats that we currently do. And I try to tie that history with a relevance for today's efforts in international agreement and diplomacy. But today, I wanted to really emphasize the architecture and design, the mid-century architecture, the interior design, the cultivated landscape, the art collection of the Annenbergs, and their commitment to hospitality, to gracious hospitality, as a part of what makes up Sunnyland's style. I also want to add a section about the challenges that these design elements present to us at Sunnylands. So, we were charged with preserving Sunnylands in excellent care and condition. So we have this preservation ethic that the Annenbergs directed us to do in their Declaration of Trust, which established the Annenberg Foundation Trust at Sunnylands. So we have to preserve the estate, but we have to preserve it for the purpose of using it. That's a very different kind of dynamic. Many times you're preserving something, it becomes a museum, it's set aside, and nobody touches anything. In our case, we need to welcome people to come and feel the specialness of being at Sunnylands and interact and sit on our furniture. And we have a special responsibility here in the desert. The Annenbergs in the 1960s created a 200-acre estate and reflected what was typical of Americans in the 1960s, a belief that resources were limitless. We in the 21st century recognize that we have to be responsible stewards of the water available here in the desert. And so a huge part of what we do is tied to sustainability and an effort to reduce the impact of water use on our estate. So my story actually today starts off with the four people who were most important, the four people who were instrumental in creating this special place from an aesthetic standpoint. And so first, I want to talk about Leonore and Walter Annenberg. In 1963, they decided to build a winter home in the desert. And Walter, of course, was a successful businessman. He owned Triangle Publications, Inc. It published 17 magazine and TV Guide, probably the largest circulation magazine in America for decades. And he owned a number of TV stations. They broadcast programs like American Bandstand, for example. Both of the Annenbergs held the rank of ambassador. He as ambassador to the Court of St. James under President Nixon, and she as chief of protocol under President Ronald Reagan. And the third thing we always like to point out about the Annenbergs is their importance as philanthropists. They were probably the greatest philanthropists of their own generation, and they most certainly modeled a scale of giving that impacted current philanthropists like Warren Buffett or Bill Gates, both of whom visited Sunnylands and connected with the Annenbergs over the years. So, first two people of our four are Walter and Leonore Annenberg, and here I'm showing you a photograph of William Haynes, the interior designer. He had been a silent movie star, and he turned in the 1930s to interior design for Hollywood celebrities. I chose this photo, which isn't the most beautiful photo or glamorous one of him, but it shows him standing in 1963 on the property which would become Sunnylands. So you see the landscape that was to be developed and the amount of creative energy that would need to go into changing the open, undeveloped desert into a parkland setting. William Haynes was a partner. He was a partner in a design firm, a design team that had created the home for Sidney and Frances Brodie in 1950, and for Armand and Harriet Deutsch. Wow. in 1960, and those homes were examples of a mid-century modern style. And the Annenbergs were very acquainted with those. They were friendly with those couples, and they had visited often. And the final player in this development of style was Archibald Quincy Jones, Quincy Jones, of the firm Jones and Frederick Earl Emmons. Jones is best known for the designs he did for Eichler homes. Those are more modest homes done in California, and for his case study house number 24, which he designed for Arts and Architecture magazine. And he did a significant amount of commercial work. His role as a professor of architecture at the University of Southern California, and later he was the dean of their School of Architecture, gave him a prominent position in California architectural circles. So those four people essentially create what becomes Sunnylands. A. Quincy Jones provides provides drawings in August of 1963, and this watercolor collage, which actually was done by an individual in his office, Kaz Nomura, shows you the very first aesthetic views of Sunnylands. The Annenbergs asked Quincy Jones to create a house that would be comfortable and that would be inspired by a Mayan theme. Now, if you look at this image, you see that there are three pyramidal roofs and you see battered walls that actually go into a lake area. This inspiration probably came from the pyramids at Chichen Itza or Uxmal, and were part of an interest that was developed in the 1960s. Latin American architecture and art, some of the architects like Oscar Niemeyer were well known, or being their work was being discussed here in California. Also, Frank Lloyd Wright did two houses in Los Angeles. He did the Hollyhock House in 1921 and the Innes House in 1924 with Mayan types of themes. So we have an owner who's told an architect, I want a house that has this look that's connected to the geography and the history of the place. Now, one of the visual elements that's connected to the Mayan theme, then, this pyramidal roof, and here what we're doing is we're seeing an aerial view of the pyramidal roof, and there's only one in the final design, and here you see an emphasis on triangles as a part of the geometric underpinning of the roof form. This actually is above a skylight, which throws natural light into the middle of the atrium. Another element of the style that Quincy Jones used in this house has to do with these, what we call egg crate coffered ceilings. This is a cantilevered section that overhangs the entrance to the house. And in it, you see that there is, again, a bit of an emphasis on, in this perspective, a triangular view, but also on a square grid. And you're going to see that over and over within the house. When you walk in the front door, you see the central garden area in which Auguste Rodin's sculpture of Eve stands, but you are also made aware of the steel columns, these four steel columns that stand in the middle of this open space, a very large open space, by the way, about 6,400 square feet, perhaps the size of five typical American homes in the 1960s. And yet, the size of the space does not feel overwhelming when you're there. The steel columns, we have a fun story about that. Mrs. Annenberg came in while the house was under construction. The columns had holes in them, as all steel does, and they were unpainted, and she took one look at it and said, "We have a monster on our hands." And so the solution to the monster was to peg the open holes in the steel. And so you see those circular plugs, and to paint them celadon. So the architect was allowing you to see the materials that made up this house, and the Annenbergs were much more interested in a more pleasing kind of view in color and texture. But that introduction of the circle plays in a bigger kind of design aesthetic. So you have the squares in that coffered ceiling area and circles in the columns. And here you see it a little more closely. Rodin's Eve is standing directly underneath this monitor that allows the light through the skylight. And can you see the circular cutouts on the metal wings that are there? And it opens as a square. And that whole idea of using geometries goes as far as the doorknobs. This one is a beaded metal doorknob. This style comes from Schlage, is used throughout the house. And of course, one of the major materials used in the construction of Sunnylands was concrete block. That creates a series of concrete block square patterns, and that is played off against elements of nature outside the house. So you'll see that as we go through today's talk. And I wanted to take you from the actual built house to a floor plan of it to see the layout of these circles and squares as they organize the experience of being at Sunnylands. So over, this is the entry court. And here is the Mexican column that stands outside the front door. You see that that is a circular entry court, that you're coming into that large square open space, which is the living room and atrium. And notice that that square edge, which you could also then look at as a triangle, it is carried on outside under trellises into the lake. And so that playing with a grid throughout the house is obvious in many different places. I know you can't see this, but I wanted to show this floor plan, which is a furniture plan of the living room. And if you can follow along, these are sofas and tables and more sofas, tables and chairs. And the red writing is added by William Haynes, the interior designer. So he early on noted exactly where to put things and which things to put there. His style, A. Quincy Jones established an amazing space, and it's very typical of mid-century spaces in the sense that it's open, that you can look out the windows, often walls of glass, to the outside, and you see this integration of outside and inside. But a typical mid-century house might have had furnishings by Charles and Ray Eames, or by Werner Patton, or by George Nelson. And those mid-century designers were very committed to using industrial materials. William Haynes, for Sunnylands and for most of his projects, was interested in new modern shapes, but had a real commitment to a quality of fabric, texture, and craftsmanship that you generally don't see for many of the other modern designers. So, remember the celadon painted four steel columns? This is a view of the walls, which in most of A. Quincy Jones's houses would be unfinished. You would look at the wood and you'd look at the beautiful grain of the wood and it would not be painted. At Sunnylands, we have celadon painted wood paneling, which again creates this visual relationship between objects, colors, and the space in which they are. It does definitely reflect Leonore Annenberg's personal preferences. So pale green, pale yellow, pale pink, those are certainly colors that were some of her favorites. Now, the amazing thing about William Haynes is that he designed every single piece of furniture in the house. And this is a very large house, 25,000 square feet. So it's a lot of furniture. And we were able to locate in the William Haynes archives examples of the early watercolors that he provided to the Annenbergs to show what his design furniture could look like. So here on the top you see an inlaid table with a pedestal base that ended up essentially in the dining room. The middle table was actually narrowed and it now sits in the living room area and holds our five tong funerary figures. And on the bottom, this side table combination was used in many areas within the house with different finishes in each room. So what William Haynes was doing was creating workable furniture with various, often complex finishes. This, of course, is one of my favorite pieces of furniture in the house. It is a sofa that plays off a Regency Recamier style, which is essentially a day bed that has this curved edge, and sometimes it has it on two ends, sometimes only one. But note that it has a back that is straight and flat and low. And so if you just look at the shape, you can see that it's reflecting a modernist approach to furniture. However, note that the shape has this what's called biscuit tufting. And so there's a softening of the shape, but not a squishiness. There's no way that you can go throw yourself on that sofa and you know, sink into it. Leonore Annenberg preferred that sofa in this way with pillows in her master bedroom. And this, of course, is kind of indicative of that meeting of the aesthetic of the owner and the designer and the ways in which the owner brought their own taste to the mix. Now, William Haynes designed all this furniture. The house was built from 1963 to 1966. The Annenbergs went off to London while he was ambassador from 1969 to 1974. And when they came back in 1974, they wanted to change the way the house worked for them. They wanted it to be more formal. And they actually created a formal dining room. At that time, William Haynes did this drawing with a new sideboard and note the painting over it. The Annenbergs also decided in 1974 that they would include their collection of Impressionist and Post-Impressionist paintings at Sunnylands. So William Haynes and the architect Harry Saunders, who had worked with A. Quincy Jones, work to create a slightly more formal house. And this is what you would see today when you come and visit the dining room. There's the piece of furniture, the George Jensen silver sits on top of it with beam roses and the painting above. Now, of course, it's no longer the original painting. The collection was given to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York basically promised it in the 1990s, and it went there permanently in 2002 after Walter Annenberg died. Now, remember the Annenbergs had made a request for a Mayan theme. So A. Quincy Jones, the architect, and William Haynes, the interior designer, both agreed on this dark red lava stone wall. And what do you pick up from this? Again, a square pattern. It really works with those concrete cement blocks, right? But it ties to those pyramids at Chichen Itza and the kind of material that one saw there. So this pattern then became the backdrop for the Annenbergs' collection. And they, of course, had a collection of paintings that was considered the most important Impressionist, Post-Impressionist collection in America in the 1990s. And it glowed against this dark wall, this lava stone, which was very atypical of the way paintings of that era would have been displayed. I do want to point out the low slung seating. This also is William Haynes designed furniture. But William Haynes, when he designed things, wasn't happy with simply the beauty of a shape. He was very connected to the details of the fabrics and the way in which one finished the shape. And so in this instance, you can see the fabric on the sofa, which has a almost a trellis-like design. But down at the bottom, here, let me see if I can do this. This is called a unicorn leg. And that's because William Haynes had the metal legs of the sofa wrapped in a cream leather in a spiral that looks like the spiral of a unicorn's horn. Haynes loved the geometry of shapes in furniture, but he also loved to soften it to some extent. So here you have that biscuit tufting, which we see on many of the pieces of furniture at Sunnylands. This is an example of the trapunto quilting, which was done on many, many pieces of chairs or sofas. And what it is this, it's a three-dimensional technique, which allows for a three-dimensional design that's made fuller from the back. In this case, you're seeing it on the seat of a chair. In this instance, you're seeing trapunto being covered by flat embroidery. So some of our sofas have flat embroidery with trapunto, and as you might imagine, that required an amazing level of craftsmanship from individuals working in the 1960s. So, A. Quincy Jones made the space. William Haynes designed the furniture and ensured that there would be a quality, a high level of craftsmanship in the furniture. And he also encouraged the Annenbergs in their collection of and pursuit of Chinese objects. So I'm showing you one of five of our Tang Dynasty funerary figures. This is with a three-color Sankai glaze. And they stand in the atrium area of the house. But the Annenbergs didn't extensively collect Tang work, but they did amass an amazing collection of Chinese cloisonné and also Chinese porcelain in general. And those collections, although stimulated by William Haynes, were fostered and carried out over time by the Annenbergs. This I'm showing you actually a Qing Dynasty cloisonné crane. It's one of a pair. It stands on either side of the fireplace in the living room. And of course, in 1971, Walter Annenberg was approached by the Steuben Company to acquire a collection called Asian Artists in Crystal. And that collection, which had been developed under the under Eisenhower's presidency as an arts and diplomacy effort, really resonated with Walter. So not only did he buy the remaining pieces in the collection, but he commissioned the additional works that had already been sold to be reproduced. And at Sunnylands, you now see the only a complete collection of Asian artists in crystal. This is a piece made by an American artist, glass artist, in Corning, New York, using a drawing from a Pakistani artist that is engraved on the object. This combination of art from the West and the East was part of that desire for art and diplomacy and progress in cultural arts. Oh, I couldn't pass up showing you this quote from William Haynes. So highlighted, it says, "Most people do not have taste. Never know they don't have it. Thus, being extremely happy, like all people who have not been exposed to beauty beyond the point of their noses." So William Haynes, he did believe that the Annenbergs had some taste. Then there are the exquisite few who do have taste. And at the bottom he says, "I suppose I was trying to say that your house first should reflect yours and Lee's taste and interests, which I can easily see are very inquisitive and Catholic." So early on, William Haynes is talking to them about their taste. Now, the next element of style at Sunnylands really applies to the Annenbergs themselves. And this photo from 1968 shows them resting after a weekend with guests, and you see the style, her sense of style, certainly, wonderful pink outfit down to the pink pumps that are there in the lower right. This photo, also taken in 1968, emphasizes the stylish fashions that she wore, but also behind her, note the orchids that are in a Chinese container, and the floral designs on that sofa. So they're throughout the house, and really largely because of Leonore's love of flowers, there is this integration of art and nature. And flowers play a major role both in the design of the objects and in the fact that flowers were so much a part of the experience of being in the house. That idea of style extended to the way in which they entertained. So every element of a dinner party was carefully thought out. And here you see that inlaid table with George Jensen silver and Beam Leonore Annenberg roses set up and ready for a luncheon. And here we have an example of the menu that was used at the Queen's luncheon in 1983. So there was an attention to detail that led to a consistency of style at the house. And of course, one could talk about the style of the guests who came to Sunnylands. And so, as you all know, 7 presidents visited Sunnylands during the Annenberg's lifetime. Here I'm showing you a photo of President Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan in 1985 at a New Year's Eve party. And I love her dress. It's very definitely an 80s dress. But in addition to the presidents, the Annenbergs entertained British royalty. They had become very friendly with the British family, royal family, while Walter was an ambassador. And so in 1983, Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip visited the house, and as did many other royals. And the style of Hollywood celebrities was on view most weekends at Sunnylands. Here you're looking at Bob Hope. He's dancing at a New Year's Eve party. His wife, Dolores, is over there singing on the right. And He would have been joined by Frank Sinatra, Jimmy Stewart, Dinah Shore, and any number of the great names of the 60s, 70s, 80s. In addition to Hollywood celebrities, you would have found in the crowd business tycoons, museum directors, college presidents, and it was something about the mixing of people from a variety of cultural and business backgrounds that brought this vitality to the style of Sunnylands. But for us, the Trust, there are some challenges presented by this stylistic history, both in the physical objects and in trying to carry forward some of the captured moments from the Annenberg's lifetime. So I am showing you a photograph of President George H.W. Bush meeting with the Prime Minister of Japan, Toshiki Kaifu, in 1990. Note that they are seated on William Haynes furniture, and see the Trapunto quilting, obvious on that sofa in the chair, and note the Chinese porcelain-based lamp. Now, do you see the same lamp? Do you see the same sofa? This photo, taken in 2013, when President Obama visited Sunnylands and met with President Xi Jinping of China and his wife, Madam Peng, the White House had pored over our archives. They wanted to be certain they understood how previous presidents had engaged while at Sunnylands, and they purposefully had this meeting in exactly this spot because they had seen that photograph of President Bush. Now, it's a lovely thing to carry history forward, but it doesn't always work quite that easily. So I'm showing you a photograph of what this section of Sunnylands looks like normally. This is the William Haynes designed area. You see the furniture, and you see the Claude Monet water lilies above. Okay, see it. This is what it looks like when President Obama needs to have a photograph taken to document a meeting. So here he's meeting Xi Jinping. Note that our Rembrandt Peale, 1859, of George Washington, is now hanging in place of the Claude Monet. And then there were flags on both sides, and they're actually sitting on chairs that come from the Room of Memories. So the White House needs to communicate a certain message about a meeting, and sometimes the furniture that is there doesn't do that. In addition, I show you this photograph, which is, again, exactly the same kind of setup with President Obama and King Abdullah of Jordan when they met. And so you can see that it resonates, it says something about America if George Washington's there, but it also allowed for the press and the photographers to capture the moment. So of course we had to remove all the furniture from the living room in order for that to happen. And then ultimately George Washington, after a presidential visit, goes back to the Room of Memories, his real home, and those chairs are marked underneath. President Obama sat here. President Xi Jinping used this chair. So the challenges that we face have to do with how one preserves a historic house and uses it. So we have one kind of challenge when the president comes, but we regularly have retreats. And they might look like this. This is a photograph from a 2012 retreat. Notice that everyone's meeting at a table, and does the sofa look familiar and the flat embroidery, right? This is a photo from that same retreat, actually. Condoleezza Rice is speaking with former Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa of Los Angeles, and there are these people, and what are they doing? They're sitting on that sofa with the beautiful flat embroidery, right? And if you look to the right of Condoleezza Rice, you can see a wine glass. So there, some of us who work for Sunnylands come from a museum background. Our heart stops when we look at the wine glass. But unlike most historic sites, we are established for the purpose of making certain that the people involved in that meeting are completely comfortable, engaged, and involved in the Sunnylands spirit. So we have other strategies that we try to use to protect the fabrics. Now, I'm showing you a picture of the game room. When the trust inherited the house in 2009, the furniture in this room was the most fragile. It had been frayed, and there were actually almost holes starting to be seen on that sunflower hand-painted fabric, right? So our solution, in order to make certain that when people come, they feel that this is a fresh experience, that it's really wonderful, and that they're comfortable there, was to begin a project, which is a fabric replication project. We are working with a New York firm. We have replicated exactly the original fabric. We reinforced the support for the furniture. We recovered the furniture, and it now is back in the game room, which looks exactly like it did when it was first finished. Another strategy we use, and that fabric should last decades again, so we've got it set up for some really great interactions. Another strategy we use is that sometimes we have the meetings in a newer building on our campus. And so this is called the Retreat Pavilion. It was designed by the architect Frederick Fisher, and he created this lovely little glass box. About 16 people can have a great meeting in there. Doesn't matter if they sit on chairs, doesn't matter what they spill. And it is adjacent to our cottage campus. So another challenge that we have that relates to style is not inside the building, but outside. So I'm showing you a photo of President Eisenhower. There he is, fishing in the lake in 1966. And I want you to see the bougainvillea that's trailing over the edge of that bermed wall, and see the tree between the trellis and the roof. Now, go back a moment. In 1963, remember, this is what the landscape looked like as the Annenbergs were envisioning this place. And they worked with A. Quincy Jones, with Emmett Wemple, who was a well-known landscape designer for a brief time, and with the horticulturalist Rolla Wilhite to create the landscape part of this project. And I liked this early drawing because A, it shows the horizontality of the whole house with that single pyramidal roof, and it shows how the plantings soften the geometries of the house. So an early photograph, same area that essentially that President Eisenhower was in, see the bougainvillea, see the trees. The issues that we grapple with are that a landscape which has an original design intent, the architect and the designer knew what they wanted it to do, but landscapes change both in size and in scale and the lifespan of the plants. So this photograph, taken in 2006, shows no bougainvillea along that bermed wall, right? And topiary trees. So the topiary trees were a solution that the Annenbergs came up with based upon the growth of those trees. The trees got too big to fit between the trellis and the roof, so what were they going to do? They ultimately came up with the topiary as a solution. Another thing that happens with bougainvillea in the desert is that if we have a terrible freeze, the bougainvillea is negatively affected, right? So over time, in various areas, the bougainvillea was taken out and grass was put in. That does not meet the original design intent of A. Quincy Jones and Rolla Wildheit. And that's because what they wanted was to soften the geometry of the house with the organic and natural shapes of the landscape. So when the trust inherited the house and needed to do its major restoration, what we did was take it back to its original look. Here you're seeing that new bougainvillea starting to creep over the side of the bermed wall and the trees between the trellis and the roof. We hope that we will be able to come up with some maintenance practices that allow us to keep that natural look for the exterior. And this photo, what's the overwhelming color in this photo? Don't look at the mountains. Green. It's green. That 200-acre estate had 180 acres of turf when it was first completed. And it was kept green during the entire Annenberg's lifetime. That presents us with some very significant challenges because we can't use that much water, essentially. Responsibly, we can't. So I'm showing you a photograph. Here are the Eisenhower palms, the two that were planted after President Eisenhower came and saw the estate and said, you don't have any palm trees. And so they planted two. And they're on the golf course, and you're seeing an element of the Dick Wilson design golf course with the raised green surrounded by the bunker. But what you're also seeing, and this photograph was taken in 2015, is a difference between an area that was overseeded one way and another. We began a process of not overseeding everything in order to experiment to see how could we reduce water use. And of course, when you overseed out here in the desert, you have to throw so much water on to get the new seed to germinate. So you're seeing it there. You're also seeing from this aerial view of the Chinese pavilion, which is on the grounds, a look at one of the follies, but you're seeing it contained in a green area with a surrounding area that was also not overseeded. By 2016, last year, we had developed a new approach for overseeding and the reduction of water use. First of all, we took 60 acres out of irrigation. So now instead of having 180 acres of turf, we had 120. Then we determined that if we only overseeded the 10 acres, essentially directly around the house, we could, for 2 months of the year, talk to our public about responsible water use. We could help them understand that gold, manicured and beautiful, because this was a very finished landscape, could be just as beautiful as green. But we didn't change the views from the house. So if you're inside the house and you're looking out, you're still seeing the green views that are historically accurate, but you're seeing that whole project within a 200-acre estate that is much more water sensitive. So in here I'm showing an earlier, you can see around the edges areas that were taken out of turf. You're seeing the historic estate and adjacent to it, the public center and gardens, which references the historic estate in a variety of ways. And so from a style standpoint, at the Center and Gardens, and I hope all of you know that you can go Thursdays through Sundays free from 8:30 to 4 and thoroughly enjoy the Sunnylands aesthetic. This building was designed by the Los Angeles architect Frederick Fisher and Partners. It was completed in 2011, opened in 2012, and it conducts a conversation between contemporary architecture and mid-century modern architecture. So there are elements of mid-century design in this building, but they are not replicating. It's not an attempt to reproduce mid-century style, but it is an attempt to help you use your eyes and begin to see the references that exist, the similarities and the differences. And the same kind of a dialogue, we hope, is encouraged by the garden on the public side, which is made up only of arid landscape plants. So this garden, designed by the office of James Burnett, was inspired by the Annenberg's collection of Impressionist and Post-Impressionist paintings. That collection then becomes a living landscape. And the beauty and the aesthetics of the landscape are there, but they are created by plants which are suited to our environment and therefore hopefully help to create a 21st century oasis as opposed to the 20th century oasis that the Annenbergs created. And so ultimately, it's the beauty of the public space which introduces visitors to the central idea of Sunnylands. And I'm just going to end with this. I think Sunnylands is at once a place and a philosophy. And that philosophy puts its arms around things like hospitality, where hospitality and graciousness are an integral part of creating a relaxed atmosphere, and that relaxed atmosphere and that ability to take in the beauty around you seems to encourage substantive conversation. And that, of course, helps us to meet our primary mission. And I think for us, the big challenge is to balance our three basic value systems, preservation, reuse, and sustainability, and to in achieving that balance, to achieve the state of mind that is Sunnylands. So thank you.